I'm Steve Croft.
I'm Leslie Stahl.
I'm Bob Simon.
I'm Morley Safer.
I'm Scott Pelley.
And I'm Kelsey Loy. Tonight on 60 Minutes, we will be doing an investigative report on the infectious disease, meningitis. Good evening, and thank you for joining us for this edition of 60 Minutes. Heading off to college is often a time of great excitement and preparation. But if you did not receive a meningitis vaccination, health experts say you could be putting your future at risk. The Center for Disease Control estimates 3,000 cases of meningitis occur in the United States each year. Most of these cases involve adolescents and young adults, particularly those in college settings. We wanted to investigate what those most at risk knew about this devastating disease. We were surprised to find that many did not know the symptoms or how to prevent it. We now turn to our field correspondent, Mary Elizabeth Holroyd, who interviewed students at James Madison University in Harrisonburg, Virginia.
Hey, what do you think meningitis is?
I don't know.
And what would you do if you got it?
Probably consult a doctor.
Meningitis, I'm not sure, but I think it's some type of viral disease that could affect your kidneys.
I believe it's an infection of the throat.
It's a disease that, it affects your spinal cord, right? It had, like, fluid. It goes around the spinal cord, and I don't know.
Hi, what would you do if you had meningitis?
Go to the doctor.
Hi, do you know what meningitis is?
I think it's an infection of the cerebrospinal fluid, but I'm not sure.
Good evening, my name is Kate Stevens, and I'm here with Robert Brown today, who is an RA from James Madison University, to talk about her personal experiences with meningitis. So Robin, as an RA, what did you personally deal with in any meningitis cases?
Well, my first year as an RA, I had a resident that came down with a case of viral meningitis, and she became very ill. She went to the health center at first thinking that she had like a sinus infection or something, and she was prescribed some drugs for that. But then after a few days, she was continuing to have like headaches, neck pain, and eventually she had to be rushed to the ER, and she had to go through a full examination, and they ran a spinal tap and found out that she did have indeed viral meningitis.
So after finding out about this, what were some of the precautions that you took as an RA at James Madison University?
Well, since viral is a lot less contagious than some forms of meningitis, we didn't have to do too much to warn other residents in the area. Of course, you know, the roommate was informed and residents that lived on the hallway, just so that we could go over the different precautions that residents need to take.
What were some of the precautions that you took in order to make sure that your residents didn't catch meningitis?
Well, we definitely had a meeting to inform everybody on the floor what was going on, and especially talk with the roommate about cleaning everything down. Luckily, viral meningitis isn't as severe as bacterial meningitis, so there wasn't too many extra precautions that we need to take with the residents other than the normal taking care of yourself.
So what would be some of your advice in order to inform current and future residents of James Madison University to take care of themselves in order not to get meningitis?
We definitely want residents to clean their room, wash their hands. We encourage them not to drink after one another, just to help prevent the spread of germs and other diseases, whether it's common cold or something more severe like meningitis.
Well, thank you, Robin. Now back to you, Kelsey.
To get the most current information on meningitis, we spoke with nurse Susan Patak, a recent graduate of James Madison University and resident of Fredericksburg, Virginia.
Hi, my name is Susan Patak. I'm a registered nurse and a recent graduate of James Madison University. I'm here to talk to you today about viral and bacterial meningitis. Meningitis is actually what we would consider an infection at the brain and the spinal cord, and there are two main types, bacterial or viral. It's kind of ironic because with meningitis, bacterial is actually the one that people consider more serious. And what most people know about meningitis is that there's a serious kind and one that's not so serious. Usually with bacterial infections of other types, antibiotics can cure the infection. So most people would assume that the viral meningitis is the more severe one, which is not the case with meningitis. Bacterial meningitis and viral meningitis have many different causes. It's not just one cause, and they are contagious, which is why children and especially college students living in dorms should be vaccinated with the meningococcal vaccine. Some of the causes of viral meningitis specifically can even be from simple viruses that can cause intestinal illnesses, and the West Nile virus has recently become a major cause of meningitis. Bacterial meningitis and viral meningitis have similar causes or similar symptoms. Some of the symptoms that somebody at home might see may be fever and chills, nausea, vomiting, a severe headache, sensitivity to light, and the typical that most people expect is the stiff neck. Now, when you go to the hospital, there are several different tests that they can perform. And if you do have these symptoms, you probably shouldn't wait unless you know that it is a fever and the flu. But if you're having other symptoms, it's best to get medical attention immediately. Some of the things that they can do at the hospital to check would be lab work, blood work, a chest x-ray, a CAT scan, and most commonly a lumbar puncture to test the cerebral spinal fluid, which is the fluid inside your spinal column. A lot of times when you do get to the hospital, the symptoms that the doctor might notice would be increased heart rate, tachycardia, fever, and a stiff neck again. And ways that you can treat bacterial and viral meningitis would be, viral meningitis will usually go away on its own. Antibiotics will not treat it. They only treat bacteria, so that one usually resolves on its own within about 2 weeks because it is less serious. And bacterial usually requires a hospitalization with antibiotics, and a lot of times antibiotics may not be strong enough to cure it. You also want to do lots of IV fluids to prevent brain swelling, seizures, and shock.
Thank you, Susan. We need to take a short break, but when we return, we'll talk to you more about the lasting effects of meningitis and the vaccination. But first, a public service announcement from our sponsors. We were talking to resident nurse and recent JMU grad, Susan Patak, about the effects of meningitis. Susan, what happens after meningitis has been treated?
All right, now after the meningitis has been treated, or in the case of viral meningitis, if it's gone away on its own, some of the residual effects, if it was serious enough, they may have brain damage or other bodily system damage. But other than that, most people, especially with viral meningitis, should recover and be just fine. That's why it's most important to be vaccinated. Anybody who's in contact with somebody who does have either bacterial or viral meningitis should definitely be vaccinated with the meningococcal vaccine, or make sure that their vaccinations are up to date. Thank you, and thank you for your time.
So just to recap, meningitis can be bacterial or viral, but both are an infection of the tissue called the meninges, which surround the brain and spinal cord. To prevent meningitis, avoid sharing foods, drinks, or eating utensils. Prepare early by getting the vaccine and make sure to wash your hands thoroughly and often. Be aware of the symptoms, which can include fever, severe and consistent headaches, stiff neck or neck pain, nausea, vomiting, and possibly a rash. If you exhibit any of these symptoms, make an appointment with your doctor as soon as possible. Thanks again for joining us on this edition of 60 Minutes.
Hi, Cooper.
Cooper's licking the camera.
Cooper. Here. Come here. Speak. Good boy. Can you shake Kelsey's hand?
Cooper, shake.
Good boy. Lay down. Good boy. Cooper, speak. Speak. Cooper. Good boy.
Good boy.
All right, that's cute.